are so glad that you are here this morning. If you are a guest at King's Way, I just want to take a moment and welcome you. Say thank you so much for coming today. We are glad you are here. We have these little cards in our bulletins that are just for you so you can get you connected as quickly as possible. If you would fill that out during the service or sometime today and take it back to the Connections booth back there where Danny's at, we'd love that. Get that from you. If you don't have time to meet with him today, that's okay. Just drop it in the offering plate a little later in service and we'll get you connected. Apple Butter Bacon Days is this weekend. Everybody a little tired, a little worn out. Got that mist falling. That's all right. We're excited to be here together. If you would just stand up though, and welcome those around you. Say hello. Good to see you. We're going to continue in worship and sing this morning.
Hope you guys are doing good on this another gloomy morning. I'm excited y'all are here this morning as we come together just to whatever's going on around us, all the hustle and bustle of apple butter making days and everything that's going on, just to worship our God together. And that's what we're going to do because He has called us out of death, out of darkness, into light, into life. Let's praise Him this morning. So things are just a little more chill this morning, kind of matching the mood, the weather. But I just want to encourage you, whatever it looks like for you, as we don't ask for God's presence to be here, we ask God to make us aware that He is here. Whatever it takes for you this morning, just to make sure that He is the focus, we come together to worship Him. I encourage you to take that posture, whether it's standing, whether it's sitting, hands raised, as we focus on our God and our Savior.
Gonna sing it out for all the world to hear. Oh, 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 oh. It's life for everyone. A new day has begun. Something to shout about. Let it be known that our God saves, that our God reigns. We lift you up and up. Let it be known that love has come, that love has won. We lift you up, up, up. Stop us now, no one can keep us down. We found our voice again. Oh, 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 oh. No need for feeling shame. There's power in His name. Come on, let's feel the wind. Let it be known that our God saves and our God wins. We lift you up, up. Let it be known that love has come, that love has won. We lift you up, up, up.
Lord, we're here to give you glory in this place. As the The psalmist says in Psalm 115, not to us, but to you be all the glory because of your love and your faithfulness. Remind us of who you are. Remind us of what you have done, what you are calling us to.
There's a banner high. It's not for me, it's all for you. Let the heavens shake, split the sky. Let the people clap their hands and cry. It's not for us, it's all for you.
Sing this, not to us,
not to us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, to your name be the glory.
Psalm 119, the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth. Their words to the end of the world. So we join with all creation as God's creation and sing to him. Glory and honor and for praise that is due his name. Lord, we give it to you. Let's just sing this.
Glory and honor and praise. Glory and honor and praise. Glory and honor and praise. Glory and honor and praise.
Sing it again.
Glory and honor and praise. 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 Just one more time. Glory and honor and praise. Glory and honor and praise, we give it up to you, God. Glory and honor and praise. Glory and honor and earth is shaking, the earth is shaking, the mountains shouting, it's all for you. The waves are crashing, the sun is raging, it's all for you. Glory, not to us,
for to your name be the glory, not to us, but to your name be the glory.
Comes from the Lord.
always.
You knew everything, and you went there and you said, I love you. And God, that blows my mind just a little bit. But remind us of your grace, remind us of your love, remind us of the response. Lord, not that we ought to, not because we have to, but what flows out of a life that is saved, life that lives in the full life that you've called us to.
In all of the one. gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrender all. I am, it's yours. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrender all.
My heart will sing.
Jesus, Jesus, my heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. Lord, to sing your name above all. We give you all the glory and the honor and praise that is due you, that all creation cries out and sings to you. Lord, as we come together as simply part of your church, as a local church here in Mount Vernon, Lord, show us what it means to not just sing your name with our voices, but to sing your name with all of our lives as you continue to call us into your full life, where there is satisfaction, where there is hope, where there is meaning, God. We give you all the praise and the glory. In your name we pray. Amen. You guys may be seated.
So incredible to worship together like that. I am so glad that you are here today so that we could just sing and give worship to our God. Man, it's apple butter weekend. I know most of you have either been there, worked there, or are headed there. So I know that this is that time of year where, man, this weather just makes you want to stay in bed. And most of the thing that's going on in our city just feels like chaos and craziness, all the people driving everywhere. But I am so glad that you are here and that you've chosen to be here this morning, because I do believe there's some things that God has just wanted to just lay on your heart, that he's laid on Kevin and I and the elders' hearts, just some things that just we're just wanting to make sure that you guys are just on board, that we're all running together this incredible race and this incredible pursuit of God. And so this morning I just titled this message, Fully Pursued, Fully Pursuing. And it's just kind of a standalone thing that kind of blends into the next 2 weeks. And I just want a chance to just really share from the bottom of my heart and really from the leadership's heart what Kingsway is all about. What Kingsway is really all about and what we are calling you to and what we are pursuing ourselves. And it's just such a beautiful thing when we are all on the same page doing the same thing. I don't know if you guys have watched children's soccer. You guys ever watch children's soccer? It's a sight to behold. It really is. Like six-year-olds to eight-year-olds, they start to figure it out, but before then, it's for the parents. And then for them, it's just energy out. You know what I'm saying? Like, you put them on a field, you put a jersey, you tell them there's a ball, you tell them there's two goals, and then you just cut them loose. Right? And they're just going nuts. I mean, there's three or four of them that are super competitive, and they're over there kicking the thing as hard as they can. Then there's the three or four that have no idea why they're out there. You know, they're like, this is pretty. This is pretty. See this, Mom? So get the ball. Okay, I'm getting the ball. Like, you know, and you're just, they're all over the place. And then all 10 of them most of the time will be right around the ball, and then the goals are completely unguarded. You know what I'm talking, you know what I'm saying? And then one will squirt out. Right, the ball will squirt out, and the fast one gets there first, but has no idea how to dribble because his feet are 10 times too big, and he's trying to kick at it, and probably will fall, and then the rest will help him up before they get the ball. You remember this? Just trying to describe to you the spectacle that is children's soccer. Well, the crazy thing is, there's supposed to be goals and ideas and things that they're supposed to be doing together, but because of the confusion and the chaos and the lack of communication or the over-communication that hasn't really taken place, the game doesn't look like really it's supposed to be played, and there's really no idea, and winner or losers is more like what juice pack you got, or how much candy was afterwards, or what friend is coming to your house now, rather than the game itself. And I think sometimes we can feel that way about church, and about the mission that we've been given in Christ, and sometimes we can get to this place, and we can sing some songs, and we can do some things, and it just feels like children's soccer. You know, like you're like, wow, they're doing awesome over there. That's cool. Oh, that person fell down. We should help them. You know, and or we're pursuing goals. And I just, for today, I just want to lay out simply as possible. And we've talked about this year. If you've been a part of Kingsway and you've been attending, we have talked about a lot of these things a ton this year. But I want to clarify. Yet again, I want to specify, I want to show you as clear as I can the purpose and the mission of Kingsway. because it is something that is, it's not children's soccer. We're not just here to have a good time and to get orange slices. Like, we're here with a purpose and a drive. And it is so incredibly important that we are all on the same page, the same team, and we are running together. So I want to say this very quickly, that Kingsway's mission statement, you've heard me say it before, we're going to put it on the screen, it says this: to see those far from Christ find full life in Christ. That is what we are all about at Kingsway. It is the verse that, or it's that saying that we attach to two verses, and it's something that is so incredibly central to the things that we think about, the things that we do, the programs that we're running, the things that we're thinking about pursuing and going after, the things that we're hoping for you is found in this statement. And it's so incredibly powerful. It comes from two verses. It comes from Matthew 28, 19 and 20. As we're those far from Christ, we say this in Matthew 28, 19 and 20, Jesus says, therefore, go and make disciples. Go and make disciples of every nation, baptizing them, teaching them, growing them, make disciples. It's just an incredible thing. And it is so funny because, and he says, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And they're like, sweet, that's it. But when you read that, I think sometimes it's easy to go, okay, so we need to go. We need to do something. We need to get out there. But really what he's saying is this: there are people that need me. There are people that need me. There are people that have not found me. There are people that are lost. And just like last week that we talked about this idea of that Jesus is the hope of the world. He does not say that life will be without hurt, and he doesn't say that everything's going to be awesome. He says, I am the hope of the world. And there are people in this world that are without hope because they do not have Christ. And so when we say they are far from Christ, we want each person to experience that hope, that incredible relationship that is offered in Christ. But don't miss something about this. Because I think as a Christian, it's so easy to go, okay, those people named Jesus, and to forget that the gospel is not only for those people, but it's for me and for you as well. Because there are many days that I feel far from worthy, far from capable, far from God. There are many days that I feel my inadequacy, the sting of it. I really do. And not only is this a description for those people that we know need that hope, but it's a description for us to hold. It's a description for us to remember that we are far from Christ. We are not who we are supposed to be. There is a sinfulness inside of me and inside of you that loves to show itself, that sometimes it shows itself in your marriage. Sometimes it shows the way you treat your kids or the people around you. Sometimes you feel the sting of the way someone else treats you, and you know this world is not as it should be. You know that things aren't working out as they should be. You know things are broken. And so we know that we are far from what God has designed to be, this world and each of us. And really what it boils down to is this idea of broken people helping broken people. That God uses broken people far away from Him, pulls them in, and He uses them to reach other broken people. Those far from Christ. Those far from Christ is a description of us as we search, pursue, but it's also a description of those we know need the hope of Christ. It's absolutely a part of that. And the second part of our statement, those far from Christ would find full life. And I just want to describe that to you, full life in Christ. And that really comes from John 10:10. And I know I've read this like umpteen number of weeks in a row. And some of you are like, you got it tattooed on yourself by this point. So you can just go like this, read it, or like on the bottom of your hand. I know, and I want that for you. I really do. Because John 10:10 says, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But I have come, Jesus has come, to bring life and life to the full. Life to the full. And so what we say is we want everyone to experience the fullness of Christ. We want everyone to experience that full life that he's offering. Not only do broken people help broken people, but they take them to the person that heals, that brings fullness to life. And it's just an incredible part of what we say is the mission of Kingsway. And really what we're talking about in that fullness, in this fullness, I think sometimes it's tempting. You guys remember how your parents used to rag on you when you didn't clean your room? Anybody have that? No? Good, I'm the only dirty one in here. Okay. I had this horrible ability to be able to just not figure out where the laundry hamper was and not figure out how to hang a towel back up after I took a shower. Just had a horrible, I don't know if anybody else struggled with this, but I did. And the room would just look like a shotgun of clothes and towels. And we would run out of towels because I'd have a pile in my room with a mold collection. It's total specific to me. It was awesome. Probably really healthy to breathe at night too. But I would do this, and you know what would happen is the same conversation happened. I could call my dad right now and we could go back to fisticuffs. You know what I'm talking about? Because we could talk about these moments where he would come to me and he would say things like this: "You need to pick your room up." And I'm like, "It's clean. I picked that up. See it? It was there, now it's there. I found the laundry bag." You remember this? Parents are like, "I just had this morning. I walked into the room this morning. I just had this conversation." Some of you said the same things. Oh, look, she's smiling. You're caught. But it's so funny because all I would do is I would say, "Hey, I'm trying. I'm getting better. Look, half the room's clean." Really, the closet's dirty, but half the room's clean. And all of a sudden, you know, and I would get so close. And as I got older and older, I'd get more and more of the clothes, right? And I'd only have 2 towels rather than 10 towels. And I'd be like, "I'm getting better. I'm getting better." And really, what it felt like, though, is every time he would bring it up, it wasn't good enough. I wasn't good enough. And we would just come to these fisticuffs where I'm like, "Look, Dad, I'm getting better. I'm improving." You know, and he's like, "You're fully capable of getting all the clothes off the ground and tough." And we would just, "Gah!" You know what I'm talking about? Where you can like tell each other's gum. You know what I'm talking about? Like, "Oh, winter fresh. Cool. Big red. You can smell it. It's how close you were." I'm just telling you, sometimes I think we see full life as just getting our acts together. It's just like getting everything in its right place, everything perfect. And until we get to that point, like, we're just not in the full life as Christ. And you know what, guys? I got to be honest with you. It may be my fault that I have not explained this to you clearly enough. Because that is not what the full life of Christ looks like. The full life of Christ is not all the clothes put away, all your problems and struggles taken care of, everything in your life perfect. That is not the full life of Christ that he is calling us into. See, it's not about perfection. It's about the pursuing, the pursuit. It's about the pursuit, not perfection. It's about God calling us from a place of muck and nastiness to a place that is beautiful and perfect and loving and full. And he's saying, "Come, follow me. Come to where I'm at. Watch, see how I am good. Taste and see what I can bring into your life." And he is continually doing that. He is continually pulling us towards this incredible day when he will come back and all will be restored and perfection will be seen. But until that day, it's him like a father to a child, not in anger, not out of frustration, but out of love, saying, "Follow me. I know a better way. I see things you do not see. I know things you do not know yet know. Listen to my voice. Pursue me." And when we truly do, that is when we step into the full life. We begin to pursue the full life that God is offering us in Christ. When you put those two statements together, it's broken people helping broken people pursue Christ, not perfection. And it's just, that is in everything that we want to do at King's Way. That is our mission statement. We want to do that. And I know it sounds simple, like, oh yeah, that's it. That's all it. All right, cool. We're done. Like, but how do we do that then? How does that happen? Like, if that's really what it's all about, like, if it's really about broken people helping broken people, and it's really about finding those far-off people and bringing them into this full life and teaching them to pursue, not to look for perfection or to think that you could accomplish perfection in this life, but to pursue Christ with everything they have, how do we do that? Well, I think Paul kind of had a similar thing in the New Testament. He had this similar thing that he was breaking loose from. See, Paul is one of those writers of the New Testament, and we read a lot of his works and his letters, but we don't realize what Paul was coming out of was this mindset that perfection was going to be found, that there was a way to live in the law that would be perfect. And so he had to break down this mentality inside himself and actually learn what it really meant to trust in the grace and love of God and pursue God. He had to really learn that, and we can see, and I just picked a couple verses out, in the New Testament, we see him learning this lesson and saying it again and again in his letters to encourage other believers, because I think the tendency is to just, you and I want a list, right? You do these 10 things, and full life of Christ is guaranteed, right? Here's the 10 things, just do these 10 things. And I think Paul wanted that list too, but I think the further he got, the further he saw his imperfections. The further he saw his need to be called further, to pursue more. So look what Paul, I just picked out three. These are just really cool. Paul writes a bunch of letters in the New Testament. I just picked out three kind of verses and sections of this. First one is in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 24 and 25. And this is what Paul says in these verses. Don't you realize in a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets the prize? So run to win. You see this imagery. All athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it to win a prize that will fade away. But we do it for an eternal prize. I love the imagery that he's setting up there. He's saying, it's not that your faith is something that you just go, I got it, and you store it away. It's something that you continually chase after and you train. And remember what I talked about just a few weeks ago? I said, it's not about trying, it's about training. If you want to learn how to walk in the Spirit, you have to stop trying and you have to learn how to train yourself. You have to learn how to train yourself to do things. If you wanted to learn how to run a marathon, you wouldn't just get up tomorrow and go, I'm going to try to run a marathon. No, you would train for months to get yourself physically capable of running a marathon. And it's the same with ourselves spiritually. As we are pursuing God, God is calling us and training us, showing what it looks like to really pursue and walk in this full life. It is a part of this full life journey to pursue and train your body. Look what he says then just in the second book of Corinthians. This is what he says. It's like Paul's having one of those downer moments. This is what he said in 2 Corinthians. Even though I have received such wonderful revelations from God, so to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger from Satan tormenting me to keep me from becoming proud. Three different times I begged the Lord to take it away. You guys ever had an issue in your life and you're just, God, just take this away. A sin, a temptation, a health struggle, someone else in your life. And he goes on, and this is what he says. This is one of my favorite things. Each time he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I am glad to boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ can work through me. See, the pursuit, as he's saying, is about stripping away Paul and about revealing Christ more. Time and time again, I ask God to make me enough. I ask God to take away the things that were limiting me. I ask God to remove the struggles in my life. I ask God to take this thing that would make me capable of doing it. And he said, hey, that's not how this works. It's about less of you and more me. It's about
me taking away some of the things that you're struggling with and replacing it with my power, with the things that I am, because I am perfection. And I think Paul needed to hear that in that moment. I mean, the guy that's touring around planting all these churches, he's got all these people that are looking up to him, and he's still saying, hey, I'm struggling big time. You know what I count on? I count on the power of God and myself. And I love what he says here at the end. This is just continuing just to kind of see his process as he's kind of figuring out what it really means to pursue God, not to try to become perfect. This is what he says in of 2 Timothy chapter 4. And this is one of the last letters he writes. And he's writing to his mentor, his next man up, the person he's been discipling and building up. Timothy has kind of been like his little squire, learning how to be a Christ follower at the same time, learning how to be a leader inside the church. And this is what he says to Timothy, and I love this, and this is it. That is why, as for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. This is Paul talking directly to him. The time of my death is near. End of your life. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have remained faithful. And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. The prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his appearing. I love what he says there. He's like, it's not that one day a long time ago I made it and now I have it. It's that he has continually pursued God. He has made it his lifelong dream to go where Christ is calling him, to do what Christ is calling him to do, to pursue God with everything he has. And at the end he goes, it is worth it. It has been this incredible thing. And I know my time is ending, but I'll just tell you, I finished and I cannot tell you how excited I am. I know that there's this thing that God is just waiting to call me up and say, you have done so well, you're good and faithful servant. It's not that you were perfect, it's that you were pursuing me. It's not that you had it all together, that you were sinless, it's that you were pursuing me. It's not that you had all the right answers or all the right knowledge, it's that you pursued me, that you loved me and you chased after me. Oh, well done, good and faithful servant. And Paul rests in that, and you can see it in those verses that he takes peace in that. And I think we all want to know that we've arrived, but I think we need to realize that the arrival is not our own. It's Christ that's going to arrive. He's the one that's going to come back. We are merely pursuing him, knowing that he is the one we wait for. It's about the pursuit, not perfection. Here at Kingsway, we define this pursuit, this full life in Christ, by using four words. We call them the big four. And that's just how we say, if you were to do full life, if you were to be pursuing full life, it would come out in these four areas. We say it's to follow Christ as a foundation and a first step. It's to engage in intentional relationships. It's to use faith in action to serve. To serve, and then it's to intentionally use your words and actions with your influence. And basically what I want to walk through is I want to give you small steps to begin to pursue Christ. Just four quick ones, using our big four. Here's what it is. You ready? Follow. If you want to pursue Christ, you want to know that you are walking in the full life of Christ, follow Him. 10 minutes a day will change the rest of your days. 10 minutes a day of prayer and scripture will change the rest of your days. You want to pursue Christ in a simple way. You want to take that next step to say, I am pursuing Him. 10 minutes a day will change the rest of your days. Engage in a life group. Engage in a life group. If I have one fear for you, it's that I know it's not an if, it's a when. It's not an if bad things are going to happen. It's a when bad things are going to happen. And I want for you what the same thing that Christ wants. He knows you are not meant to be alone, and He longs to surround you with people who want to help you, who want to celebrate with you, who want to encourage you and challenge you
You want to be with you and walk through life together. One of the most intentional ways that we try to create these relationships is through our life groups. If you are in a place where right now you're in an okay time, like you look around, you take stock of your life, and you're like, everything's good, all things are fine. That is the perfect time to get in a life group. If you look around and your life is in shatters, and there are so many things that are just broken, things are just, oh, they're a mess, you are in a perfect time to join a life group. You need people more. Or maybe you're in that time where you can see it coming, right? You can see the problem coming, and you know it's coming, and there's some routines, some habits, some things that are going on, the way your marriage is going, the way you're doing your parenting, something that's going on behind the scenes financially, you are in a perfect time to be in a life group. And I just want you to know, if you wait till the when, it's a lot harder. It's a lot harder if you wait till that moment. I just want to encourage you, join a life group. One of my biggest fears, one of the leadership's biggest things, and we know that we can't be there for everybody all the time. We're not meant to be. But I told you just a few weeks ago, in fact, those of you that have been comforted through some tragedy, you are specifically and uniquely qualified to comfort others through it. That's a life group. You take what God has taught you, what He has comforted you in, and you just use it to comfort others and encourage others. That's the church being the church. Intentional relationships. Look into a life group. The third one is serve. Serve one neighbor. If you're looking for a baby step into service, I didn't want it to be here. I mean, there's plenty of ways to serve here at Kingsway, but I think one of my mentalities that I have to break through because I'm a PK is like, you have to go to church to serve. You need to go to church to serve. I did the coffee. I served. I did the two-year-old. I served. And that's not a bad thing. I'm not trying to make fun of it, but at the same time, like, you go home and you're like, you know, an older lady is next door and she's like struggling to mow the grass, and you're like, the Chiefs game's on, or, you know, the Royals are actually winning, and you walk right past it, and then, like, the moment later, you're like, oh, yeah, that's probably what serve means. And I just want you to think about this for a second. You have neighbors and people just around you, wherever you're at, just neighbors. Pick one and serve them. Right in your little neighborhood. Don't like, take the church and, like, take your house as a beacon of light and serve someone around you. One person. It could be getting their mail. It could be mowing their grass. Well, the grass is going to die here a little bit. But it could be helping them cut firewood. I mean, it doesn't have to be something major. I just want you to take a step. Because I believe that is absolutely part of pursuing full life in Christ. The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. It is absolutely the definition of Jesus. The person that we are chasing and pursuing. For like Him, we will end up like Him. I mean, it's just crazy. One neighbor. Serve Him. Here's the last one, and this is the one that I want you to pay attention, because I think it could be the most confusing, but it is so incredibly important. Influence. Have that one conversation. That one intentional conversation. Maybe you have a friend whose marriage is not going well. Maybe you have a friend that they're in between jobs or they're struggling right now. Maybe you have someone that's close by that you know there was a death in the family. Maybe there's something major going on right around you in your circle of influence that no one in this church would even know is going on, and you need to know you are the person to have that intentional conversation. Do it with love. Do it in caring, kindness, in the hopes for reunion, restoration, and growth, not for destruction or damning someone or making them feel like they're less worthy, but do it in a way to lift someone up. But have that one intentional conversation. And you know what it is. You may not want to say it in front of everybody, but if I put you on that wall and I put my hand in your throat, what's that one conversation? It wouldn't be a doubt. I bet you'd have one pop in. And if one's not right now, you need to put it in prayer and say, God, do I even see anything around me? Am I even being aware? Maybe you're not even being aware of the things that God wants you to use you to do. But I want you to have one intentional conversation with that person that you know you need to. This is powerful stuff. Believe me when I tell you this. Seeing those far from Christ find full life in Christ is calling people not to become perfect, because truly, you guys, the gospel is not about bad people becoming good. It's about dead people becoming alive. And we are trying to help people by giving them the hope of Christ, by saying, pursue the one that is life-giving. Pursue the one that is holy and completely able to sustain you and give you full life. And I just want you to think about this for a moment. What if we as the church, each of us, just for a moment, because individually I can speak to you, but what if corporately, what if together as the body of Christ, we started to do these things together? What if each of us started to read our Bibles and pray 10 minutes a day? What things would God begin to grow in each of us? What would happen if we all got in life groups? We began to support each other in such a way that our needs were met, that our emotional needs were taken care of, that our marriages and families were so strong that we could reach out in a way that we had never done before. What would happen if we served the people around us, not for the glory of Kingsway, but for the glory of God's kingdom? What if we began to do that in such a way? Would this world, would this city be changed? What if we had those conversations before the destruction, before the things failed, before the things fell apart? You were willing to step into that awkwardness and have that one conversation. What if we all did those things together?
Amen.
The church would be the church. We would win. We would show what Christ's victory has already proclaimed, that the church will win. We have already been declared victors in Christ. We are merely pursuing Him with everything we have, because we know in the end He wins and we are chosen. We have been picked by the King. We are absolutely His daughters and His sons, and He longs for everyone that would call on His name to be saved and to experience that hope. What would happen if we did these things together? What if we just told the world, hey, it's not about being perfect. It's just about pursuing the one that gives full life. I encourage you to come back next week. For the next 2 weeks, we are going to be talking about this vision that we believe the church has and that we believe God has called us into at Kingsway, and what it's really going to look like, how it's really going to feel. And there are some things that God has on the cusp waiting for us. Because you guys, as individuals, as a church, we are not called to be perfect, but we are absolutely called to pursue. Would you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, you have pursued us with everything you have. You sent your Son to get us. You didn't stay on high. You came after us. You left heaven and you came down to muddy earth, dirty earth, and you lived a perfect life. And Lord, I just pray, Lord, that we would pursue you in the same way, that we would give up everything to follow you, that we would surrender all, and that we would say, God, I know we can't be perfect, but I want to pursue you with everything. And Lord, will we be the church? Will we have those conversations? Will we serve? Will we surround ourselves with people that can encourage and help us? And Lord, would we trust in your word, the strength that it can provide, the sword that cuts through the dark, Lord, the wisdom that we need in those indecisions? Lord, would we pray and call on your name? Would we be to the church? Seeing those far from Christ come to full life in your Son. Lord, we love you. In your name we pray. Amen. During this time of response, I just want to encourage you to just allow God to just maybe have a little pep talk with you. Speak some wisdom and love and need comfort. Begin to maybe light a fire in you, some things that He's starting to get you to think about. Maybe there's just a way He's starting to whisper you to pursue. And I just want you to listen to Him and respond in that way that you... Maybe you speak back quietly, maybe you speak back internally, and you just begin to say, God, I want to pursue you. I know I can't be perfect, but I want to pursue you. And during this time that we have that response, we're also going to have communion up front and in the back. And what a time to just come up and submit and say, God, I remember when you pursued me, this body that was broken, this blood that was shed, you didn't stay on high, you came and gave it all.
to have me, and Lord, I will do the same for you. I will give you everything I have. It may be broken, it may not be perfect, but Lord, I will give you all I have to pursue you. We'll have some people up here in the front and the back. Elders, if you would like to pray, just for encouragement, we would love to pray with you. Let's respond together and take communion.
To listen, to allow us to be people that grow, because growing people change, God. As you call us to that full life, we don't look towards it, just simply a destination that adds guilt or weight or pressure of us not attaining. But Lord, you've taken care of that. The call to full life is a life of pursuit, to being faithful. What you have put in front of us, what you have given us, you have put us, Lord. Continue to teach us. Lord, I know that we can't be in your presence and not change. Because in you there is power and there is strength that is nowhere else. Continue to show us what it means to truly worship you with everything that we are. And Lord, as we go into a time of offering, as we give you our gifts, that is already yours, may you bless it for your name alone. In your name I pray, amen. Now they're going to be coming around with the offering plates, and I just want to remind you, we're welcome to also give online at kingswaychristianchurch.org. There is a button in the top right hand corner that says give online. Also, if you're following along in your YouVersion notes, you can. There's a little button at the bottom of there. You can takes you to where the portal that you can give. A quick, safe way to give. So I encourage you to check that out. And if you ever have any questions, feel free to let us know. I have a couple announcements for you. And we showed a video last week, and there'll be more to come. But I want to remind you that we are in full swing for Operation Christmas Child. Probably saw the booth outside when you came in. It's very Christmassy. So I know it's happening in the stores, but it's happening here too. So just want to invite you to take part in that. You can go to that booth for all the information. I know Deborah isn't here today, but if you have any questions, feel free to talk to Danny and Leanne at the Connections booth, and they'll at least point you in the right direction, or talk to Trevor and I. But basically, just to make sure you know, all it is giving shoeboxes full of toys and things to kids all around the world. So I know if you pick up a little pamphlet, it gives you a big list of things that you can put in there, what to do. But I want to encourage you, it's an awesome thing not to just only support and have a global influence this Christmas time, but it is a sweet thing to just do as a family, whether you choose to do one box or one box per person. But I encourage you to go out there, check that out. If you have any questions, that's going to be your best place to go, but you can also come talk to us. We're going to be, that collection week is going to be the second week of November, just so it's kind of coming up. So that's
about a month away, but a little less. Want to let you know the Foundations class is this next Sunday, 9 a.m. It's a class for anybody that's new to Kingsway or new to following Christ. We just highly encourage you to come and check it out. If you're new to Kingsway, it's something that we'll hopefully can be able to show you a little bit of how things work, a little bit of the vision like today that goes on behind the scenes, kind of the leadership structure with our elders and staff, and just a way too to just invite you into kind of the full vision of the church and get you connected in a deeper way. As well, if you're a new Christian, it's a way for us to just kind of talk through some of the first steps and foundational steps of being a Christ follower. So we'd love to have you next Sunday at 9 a.m. We will have childcare provided. We do have a thing that if you would stop by the Connections booth and see Danny and let them know that you were coming, that would be incredibly helpful, so we make sure we have enough people to watch kids and enough refreshments in the morning in a large enough classroom. So thank you so much. I hope you can be there.
Also coming up at the end of the month, October 29th at 5 p.m., it's a Wednesday night, is our family Halloween carnival. It's going to be happening right here in this building Wednesday the 29th at 5 p.m. John's getting all the plans and all the things ready for that. And so I want to ask, first of all, just put it on your calendar and plan to be here. But also, we need candy because we love to bless lots of children with candy.
With cavities. I mean candy.
We bless dentists as well. Parents love us. But it's a fantastic time. And so I want to encourage you to be a part. But there's a bin right outside the main office here up front that just says candy donations or something on there. So if you get a chance and you're at the store, get some candy, big bags, little bags, whatever, anything can help. Just make sure it's individually wrapped because we only want to give individually wrapped because it's kind of sketchy if you...
It's really funny when you give somebody like a handful of melted M&Ms, so I'm just throwing that out there.
That's good. So we're just asking, you guys have been so awesome just in the past with donating those, but we're starting those. So October 29th is kind of the deadline that we're giving whatever candy we have. So.
Otherwise, you'll give it to the Trevor and Kevin after that. 29th.
It works.
Hey, a couple things coming up with the youth group. We have a corn maze trip going on this Friday for our 6th through 8th graders. Information is back at the table in the back right corner. Our sign's not there, but it's the Clash Student Ministries. We had a coffee booth going on that the sign has not migrated back from yet. But we have a booth back there that has the information for the corn maze. They're leaving this Friday, right? Did I say on Friday? Okay, I'm just waiting for confirmation. They're leaving this Friday. They're going to the corn maze in Verona, and they'll be coming back to the church, so look for more information on that. And then we have an event coming up for our 9th through 12th graders called The Event. And it is a weekend retreat at Ozark Christian College in Joplin. It's $35 a person. It's November 7th and 8th. We also have a flyer back there if you'd like to check that out, and hopefully you will. I also want to let you know that today at 3 o'clock at Apple Butter Making Days, the Sticks will be performing. So our Sticks will be performing at 3 o'clock today. Most of our students and a lot of students in our student ministry are part of that, so go check that out if you're down there around 3.
At Apple Butter.
Apple Butter. Don't come here. We'll be here.
So, also, just want to give you encouragement to come back next week, October 19th. So we're not trying to be too mysterious, but just as really with some of the things that we're talking about today, where God is just kind of leading, want to have some fun stuff to kind of talk about with you guys, the church family. And so I want to encourage you to be back here October 19th, the next week, just for service.
Perfect. Our Sunday meal for today is... barbecue meatballs, cheesy potatoes, Olive Garden salad, roll, and dessert. If you are brand new to Kingsway, we'd love to offer it as a free gift to you to stay and to connect. Just stay with your family and eat. If you're not, $4 a person, $12 max for your family. Enjoy apple butter. See you guys later. Have a great week.